In our last video, I left off at replacing the front fork seals, so in this video, we're going to cover that operation, as well as the brake and clutch hydraulic systems, so that we can get started on some performance modifications a little bit later to make our Honda run even better when we finally finish this ST1300 Pan-European and make it roadworthy again. Before taking off your front wheel, be prepared to have the weight of the motorcycle shift to the back. I shift the weight beforehand by using a scissor lift on the hoist table and strapping down the back of the bike. Yes, I know it's overkill, but if I do it this way, I'm confident the bike won't fall off the hoist. And before you ask, yes, I've had them fall off the hoist when I've taken shortcuts in the past. Not proud of it. I'm not going to go through all of the details around rebuilding forks, since I've been there, done that, even made a video around it, so you can check that out if you need some instructions on doing your own forks. Virtually all conventional front forks, those are the ones that are not inverted, operate the same, so components and techniques are very similar across all bike manufacturers. So at this time, I took a moment to check the steering head bearings. I had ordered an extra set of bearings for the steering head just in case I found they had some play. You never know when somebody's been out wheeling a bike. But these ones were tight, as they should have been based on the mileage, so there's no need to replace them at this time. We're going to move on. When disassembling your forks, remember to have an oil bucket at the ready and make sure you don't lose any washers, spacers, or dampener components when you dump the fork oil. In the case of the ST1300, the fork spring sits between a spacer called the spring collar and the dampening rod. At the top of the spring is a thin washer that is called the spring seat to the spring collar. So watch for it when you spill the fork tubes and be sure to pick it up. When replacing a leaking seal, you should always replace both fork seals. If one seal has failed, the other is probably soon to follow, but more importantly, this gives you a chance to clean and rebalance the fork oil in both sides. Make sure you've cleaned all the components after disassembly and dried them with a cloth. Sludge can build up in the lower tube, and getting that out can take a little bit of effort. I use a rag twisted around a large screwdriver to get to the bottom of the tube to scrub out any debris that the cleaner has missed. Using a fork oil leveling tool, like the ProMotion unit that I use, makes getting the correct oil level easy, and the Honda fork should be 62 millimeters from the top of a compressed fork pipe. Talking about fork oil, often manufacturers hide the oil weight with clever names so that some folks are driven to buy their fluids exclusively from their dealer. The Honda ST1300 recommended oil from Honda is an SS-8. This is the equivalent to a 10 weight fork oil. I bought this Maxima fork oil, which according to their website is specifically designed to work with Showa forks on big and heavy bikes like Harley-Davidson's. Since Showa also makes the forks for most other motorcycles, including the ST, which don't operate any differently than any other fork, I'm going to try this oil out. The non-V-twin formula from Maxima mentions this design for forks with cartridge-style suspension. Honestly, there's probably no difference in the oil. The biggest factor for me in going with this Maxima oil was literally it was on sale. A final note regarding the Honda forks is the cap attachment to the dampening rod. When I took the cap off, the cap base was 10 millimeters from the locking nut on the dampening rod. The Honda shop manual says the fork cap should be screwed all the way down on the dampening rod and then the lock nut tightened up to it. I'm pretty confident this was the first time these forks were disassembled, so why would there be a difference? In reassembling them, I set the lock nut at 12 millimeters down on the threads and then tightened the cap to that distance. Now this is almost all the way down and bottomed out, but if there's a Showa specialist who knows why there would have been a discrepancy from what I found when I disassembled the forks, please let us all know in the comments section. Once assembled, realign your forks with the top of your steering trees and clamp them down to the appropriate torque specs. And again, if you need any more assistance with your own forks, be sure to refer to my other video where I take you through step-by-step rebuilding of conventional forks with even preload adjustment. Before we get to the next segment, I just wanted to ask a serious question. Are your current YouTube subscriptions keeping you up all night while you're trying to find the right information? Please hit that subscribe button now. Do yourself and me a favor. Stats show that you've already watched a couple of my videos and still haven't subscribed to Rod Rides and Wrenches. On our channel, you'll find maintenance and tech videos on a variety of motorcycles, as well as reviews on bikes and even riding gear. All this for the almost absolutely free to you, the viewer, one-time low, low price of clicking that subscribe button right now. Sounds like a pretty good deal to me.
You can do it!
So with the Heli Mini 8 bars removed, I also needed to remove the brake and clutch line extensions that were on the bike. These extensions add about 4 inches to the lines and are now just too long. Removing them was actually a bit trickier than I expected, as it was difficult to get a good hold on the inline fittings to loosen them off without stripping the heads. Ingenuity and a pair of vice grips prevailed and they are now off, but this leads me to the next task of bleeding the hydraulic systems. In comments on my previous brake bleeding videos, I've been asked how to perform the same task on a hydraulic clutch. Well, the procedure is pretty much the same, but for the point of being thorough, I'll demonstrate the bleeding process on the clutch, as well as the Honda linked or combined brake system bleed. Sometimes this system is referred to the CBS or LBS. When bleeding any hydraulic system, the first step is to ensure that we have an adequate supply of the correct hydraulic fluid for the bike's system. In this case, we're working with DOT 4. DOT 4 hydraulic fluid is glycol ether based, just like DOT 3 is, and the two types of brake fluid are compatible in an emergency. The reason that your motorcycle uses DOT 4 instead of DOT 3 is that it has a higher fluid boiling point than DOT 3. Why is the boiling point important? Well, under braking, your system generates heat at the brake pads and rotor, and this is all transferred through the calipers to the fluid. Repeated braking without adequate cooling will heat the fluid to the boiling point, generating gases in the hydraulic fluid, which reduce brake effectiveness and make them feel spongy. DOT 4 has a dry boiling point of 230 degrees Celsius or 446 Fahrenheit, while DOT 3 boils at 205 Celsius or 401 Fahrenheit. Now, what do I mean by dry boiling point? This term refers to the hydraulic fluid when it's brand new and fresh, uncontaminated by water molecules that can form in the system through use and exposure to the atmosphere. The wet boiling point refers to hydraulic fluid that has a 3.7% water contamination, or roughly the equivalent of brake fluid after it's been used for about 2 years. The boiling point of DOT 4 and DOT 3 drop off significantly once they're contaminated by water, 33% lower on DOT 4 and 32% lower on DOT 3. This is why flushing your brake and clutch hydraulic fluid every couple of years is a must-do maintenance procedure. To start, remove the reservoir cap screws and remove the cap, diaphragm plate, and diaphragm. If your diaphragm is extended, be sure to collapse it back into position. Clean it up with a cloth and set it aside. To bleed the clutch, make sure you have the reservoir full. I really didn't feel like pulling the bike back on the hoist to turn the handlebars, so I'll just have to watch this fluid a little more closely since I can't level out the bars. Next, find the bleeder screw on the clutch slave cylinder, open the bleeder valve, and attach a hose, or in this case I'm using a vacuum pump, to bleed the system. One of the questions I received on Facebook lately was regarding running the reservoir dry. You can evacuate all of the fluid, and sometimes you need to do this in order to get dirt or sludge out of the bottom of the reservoir. Just be sure to get all of the air out of the system if you do. It's easier to just keep topping up the reservoir, as it is in this case, as the fluid is pretty clean. Once we've moved a couple of reservoir volumes through the lines, you can close the bleeder valve and check out the action in the clutch. If it doesn't feel quite right, there is probably a little air in the slave cylinder, so go ahead and pump the clutch lever, hold it down against the handlebar, and release the bleeder valve on the slave cylinder while still holding in your clutch lever. You should get a good shot of hydraulic fluid out of the bleeder valve. Tighten the bleeder valve back up, and you can release the clutch and pump it a couple more times. If the action hasn't improved, repeat the process that we just covered. It can take a couple of times to clear all of the air out of that last little bit of the system, so just
keep at it and repeat the process. So that's it, the clutch is bled. Make sure to top up the hydraulic fluid and reinstall the reservoir cap and all of those components. For bleeding the brakes, I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time here. I already have a couple of videos on this. Just be sure to bleed your brakes starting with the left front caliper, then move to the right front caliper as the second one to bleed. One point I do want to make about this Honda ST is to make sure you're always on the correct bleeder valve, which in this case is slightly bigger and on the front calipers is higher than the other bleeder valve that you're going to see. These other bleeder valves are for the Honda combined brake system. This system uses a proportioning valve to transfer brake force from the front and rear brakes to each other. As similar in theory to the system you'll find on most cars. On your bike, this system transfers fluid from the rear brake reservoir around to all three brake calipers using the rear brake pedal as well as a secondary master cylinder which is located on that left front brake caliper bracket. When you use the front brakes, your left front caliper is allowed to pivot on a bearing and move forward, compressing a master cylinder, applying brake force through the proportioning valve. The rear brake cylinder sends a portion of its fluid forward through the proportioning valve to both front brakes in a normal sort of fashion. Bleeding this system takes a little more effort. First, you must remove the left front caliper and tilt it forward 10 to 15 degrees from its normal position. This movement allows hydraulic fluid to flow through the combined brake system since the system will not normally do this without pressure on that secondary master cylinder. I used my electric impact to rest the caliper on and it seemed to work just fine. You can use a bungee cord or other physical method to hold the caliper up. You just have to tilt it forward, like I said, 10 to 15 degrees. Now move to the brake's proportioning valve, which is located on the right side of the motorcycle frame, beside the ignition coil. Attach your vacuum bleeder and start bleeding the system. This is going to take longer than the main brake system since the combined brake system runs through all three calipers. Keep an eye now on the rear reservoir brake fluid, since this is where the system is fed from and will require diligent top-ups. When the system has bled, go ahead and close the proportioning valve bleeder and be sure to re-secure the front caliper back on the rotor and fork before doing anything else. Now you can pump the rear brakes and test the firmness of the system. If you want to ensure you have all of the air out of the system of any caliper or slave cylinder, you can attach just the hose from your vacuum bleeder to the bleeder valve in question, open it up, and then pump the brake lever, or clutch lever as it may be, and watch the fluid rise in the tube, ensuring there are no air bubbles. Once satisfied, you can go ahead and close that bleeder valve and then remove the tube, but just be careful not to spill the fluid everywhere, holding your finger tightly over the open end before disconnecting the hose from the bleeder valve should make that a little bit easier. Now you can go ahead and top up the reservoir and secure the diaphragm and cap. You've bled the combined brake system. Just that easy. Next time we talk performance on rod rides and wrenches and get into some mild mods to help our ST1300 perform on those local twisty roads. If you didn't catch the previous two videos on the ST1300, check them out. And recently I picked up a new AGV K6 helmet that I'm very, very happy with. And you can see a full review on the channel. So until next time, thanks for liking, subscribing, and ride safe.